Welcome to worship at Providence, or in your home, or wherever you may be, but welcome to worship. And we do join together as the body of Christ to worship our Lord. So let us be joined spiritually, let us be joined together in friendship, let us be joined together in every way we possibly can, though we cannot gather together at this particular time. However, we are going to try to gather for worship on outdoor worship service on September the 20th. We will have a 9 o'clock worship service. It will last about 30, 35 minutes or so. And you will have to sign up on Sign Up Genius, and we'll only have about 40 slots. But we would like to try this and see how it goes. So more information will be coming to you about that by way of email. Also, we are going to begin opening the sanctuary, this wonderful place, for folks to come in on Fridays from 10:30 to 1:30 in order to meditate or have prayer. Again, there will be a sign up for that, and there will be about 30 slots available every Friday, and there's more information coming to you by way of email about how that will happen. And Lawless got an announcement about Rally Day, I believe, correct?
Yeah.
The Christian Education Committee just met this week and decided that Rally Day will be the 13th of September. And this year, the way we do Rally Day will be a little different. Children and youth will come to the CLC, near the CLC building, and fifth grade and younger children and families will drive through and stop by and pick up their muffins and maybe other gifts and say hello to their teachers and will leave. And middle school and high school students will also come and meet with their teachers, and they'll have a small social distancing in-person gathering time on the church campus. For the adults, Sunday school classes, we're working on it, and we'll announce through email, and also maybe next week's worship, we'll announce it in detail. And all Sunday school classes will start on the 20th, September 20th, and we'll send out more information about it. Thank you.
We join together for worship this day. People of God, we are united as one body.
Let us present this body for the worship of God.
People of God, we are inspired by one Spirit.
Let us welcome this Spirit in praising the Lord.
People of God, we are made as one and inspired as one, and yet we have many gifts.
Let us offer these gifts in the service of love.
Let us join together in prayer. O God of our salvation, you are the source of wisdom and joy. Your love and mercies are not limited to one time or to one people. You continue to heal and to save, transcending the artificial boundaries and barriers we set. For such expansive love, it is our right, it is our duty, it is our joy to offer you all our thanks and praise, now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you.
morning psalm this morning comes from Psalm 149. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise in the assembly of the faithful.
Let Israel be glad in its maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king.
Let them praise his name with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre.
For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He adorns the humble with victory.
Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy on their couches. As we enter into this time of confession, hear these words. All we are called to do is love everyone. Yet as simple as it sounds, by our actions and our words, we know how difficult a task it is. Yet, God is love. Amid the countless things that human beings cannot fully comprehend about God, there stands this. God so loves us as to bathe us with grace and feed us with mercy and forgive our sins. So confident of the love of God, let us pause and let us pray in silence. And after a few moments, I will offer prayer. While we were still held down, while we were still enslaved to sin, you died for our salvation. Yet we still worship the false gods of the world, forgetting that you are Lord. Loving worldly wealth, we have not loved you with our whole heart, nor loved our neighbors as ourselves. Trusting worldly strength, we have not trusted your word, nor followed the word made flesh. Forgiving by worldly norms, we have not shown mercy to others as you have shown mercy to us. Forgive us yet again, we pray. This in Christ's name. Amen. When we turn to God, the Lord freely forgives and pardons. We can trust in God and be not afraid. Believe the good news. Through Jesus Christ, we are forgiven now and forever. Amen.
We are one in the Spirit.
We are summer is nearly over. Are you a little sad about that? It means school is starting. And I know some of you are going to school at home, and some are going maybe one day a week and the rest of the time at home. And maybe some of you who are in preschool get to go lots of days. But the good thing is that our school routines are starting back. And before you know it, Sunday school will be starting, and your teachers will be telling you stories from the Bible. Here's a Bible storybook that I like. It's called the Jesus Storybook Bible. It has wonderful pictures in it, and here's a drawing of Jesus on the front. So maybe if you have a Bible storybook, you can read the stories, or you can ask a grown-up or older brother or sister to read to you. One story in the Bible that I love is about Moses. Have you heard stories about him? When he was born, his mother put him in a little basket and floated him on the river to keep him safe. Another time, he actually talked to God. He heard God speaking to him from a bush that seemed to be on fire. So the story of Moses is one of many strange things that we can't explain all of them. When Moses and his people, called the Hebrew people, lived in Egypt, they had a very selfish king called the Pharaoh. Pharaoh wanted everything done for him. And the people who worked for him, they were his slaves. They were the Hebrew people. And they were very tired. And if they dared complain, Pharaoh just made their work harder. They wanted God to save them. And they cried out. You remember when I told you that Moses had talked to God in the burning bush? Well, that was when God said, "Moses, I have heard my people's cries, and I am going to rescue them. You tell Pharaoh to let my people go." Moses was afraid, but God said, "I will be with you." Now, Pharaoh was selfish, and he did not want the people to leave Egypt because they did all the work. Even when God sent all kinds of plagues to try to get Pharaoh to let the people go, he wouldn't budge. One plague made the water turn to blood. Wouldn't that be awful? Another plague was hailstones falling all over the land like this. It hit the people in the head, but even worse, it killed the crops, and that was their food. So Pharaoh asked Moses, "Get God to stop this hail, and I'll let the people go." So Moses did, and do you think Pharaoh let the people go then? No, he did not. He did not keep his promise. Another time, he sent frogs. Frogs were everywhere. Now, I know children like frogs, but would you want them in your bed? Would you want them in your soup? Probably not. But look, there were frogs in their hair. I've got frogs in my hair. Oh, and in my clothes. They were everywhere. So Pharaoh asked Moses again, "Make the frogs go away and I'll let the people go." So Moses prayed to God and the frogs went away. But what do you think happened? Do you think Pharaoh let the people go then? No, he did not. He did not keep his word. Finally, the worst plague happened, and many of Pharaoh's people and even the animals died. Even Pharaoh's son died. And Pharaoh was very, very sad. And so he just screamed at Moses, "Just go, just get out of here." God had prepared Moses and the people to leave. They knew what to pack, and they gathered up all their animals and all of their families and all of their belongings, and they left. They followed Moses out of Egypt, and Moses said he was going to take them to a land that God was going to give them, the Promised Land. So thousands of them left. That must have been quite a sight. And Moses led them out of Egypt, and God was with them all the time, night and day. He never left them. Even when they were hungry and tired and even complaining, God stayed with them. He provided them with food and water and he let them know that he would never leave them. We can remember that God is always with us, even now. Moses lived a long time ago, and he led the Hebrew people to their freedom. God is still alive and active in the world. He sent Jesus to show us how to love one another and to love and serve God. We know we can trust God to keep his word to us and to be with us always. So I hope you have a great week. And just remember that God is always with you. Let's have a prayer. God, thank you for being with us. You were with Moses and the Hebrew people, and we know that you are always with us, whether we are at school, at home, or playing. We can trust you. We love you. Amen.
Love for one another. Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray.
Loving God, as you love us, help us to love others. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts together be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. About 7 years ago, while I was doing the two-year residency in ministry program in Ann Arbor, Michigan, my mentor Jay Centerford took me and two other ministers to a local food company called Zingerman's Delicatessen, and we were there to observe a weekly meeting of managers from each food division within a company that was open. The meeting was open to public. And we were there to learn why Zingerman's company was a well-respected local company and how they created a culture that encourages each worker's success. And during their meeting, each manager would talk one thing he or she appreciates about other managers. And we witnessed that when they disagreed on something, they would graciously disagree with one another. And we also witnessed that Zingerman was a healthy organization where people deal each other with respect and also with trust. In Romans 13, which I just read, the Apostle Paul teaches the church in Rome that was made up of different ethnicity, political loyalty, philosophy, country of origin, to be what Dr. Martin Luther King called the beloved community. Paul said to the people of God, he told them how, he instructed them how they should deal with one another. He said,
owe no one anything except to love one another. In the world we live in today, where people don't seem to respect and don't seem to listen to each other and don't seem to trust each other, Paul's teaching reminds us to be more understanding, more merciful, more forgiving, and more loving. Professor by the name of Richard Boyce here at Union Theological Seminary in Charlotte campus, he reminds us that this love, this command to love others, is from our Lord Jesus, and who commands us to not only love one another, but to love others and even our enemies. And Dr. Richard Boyce says Jesus is talking about real animals when we're about to love our enemies. He said, not just loud uncles or disagreeable friends. We have to love everyone. In the Christian Century magazine that was published last month, Christine Chacoyan's sermon titled "Loving the Neighbor with Whom We Disagree" was included. And regarding Paul's teaching on love, Christine wrote, "The closer we get to November's election, the harder this commandment seems." She says, "When one neighbor prioritizes the freedom to bear arms as an inalienable right, and another neighbor cherishes the freedom to wed their same-sex partner, and neither understands the other, when one neighbor promotes individual responsibility to earn a living, and another neighbor advocates minimum wage and health care for all, and neither trusts the other, it is harder still," she says, "when public leaders stoke the fires of distrust and contempt." And Christine raised an important question. What does it mean to love our neighbor in times like these? This summer, I read Howard Thurman's book on Jesus and the Disinherited, which was published about 70 years ago, and it is said that the book had highly influenced on Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And they said that he took this little book anywhere he traveled. Thurman's intent in his book is to let his readers know that Jesus lived a life that identifies with the poor, the outcast, the oppressed, and Jesus lived a life free of fear and hatred. Chapter 4 of Thurman's book is about hate. He wrote, "Hatred destroys the core of the life of the hater. Hatred bears deadly and bitter fruit. Hatred tends to dry up the springs of creative thought in the life of the hater, so that his resourcefulness becomes completely focused on the negative aspects of his environment." So he says, Jesus rejected hatred because he saw that hatred meant death to the mind, death to the spirit, death to communion with the Father. In her sermon, Christine Chalkin interprets the main message of Romans chapter 13 as our need to keep an eye on what is good. "For our time," she wrote, "this is an instruction not to dismiss the use of political leaders of other persuasions as de facto hands of the devil. Some," she says, "indeed do good. For us to wrap ourselves in the cloak of righteousness is to miss seeing the possibility that the work of God can happen through secular leaders,
that the justice desired by God can be fulfilled through politicians of different stripes, that the love of neighbor prescribed by God can be evidenced through those with whom we even violently disagree. And chapter 5 of Howard Thurman's book is about love. Howard wrote, "The religion of Jesus makes the love ethic central. The religion of Jesus says to the disinherited, love your enemy. Take the initiative in seeking ways by which you can have the experience of a common sharing of mutual worth and value." Howard Thurman says, "It may be hazardous, but you must do it." This week, our church staff, Rob, sent an email to Walt and me, letting us know that he has a friend named Jimmy Marcus Green in Connecticut, whose daughter Anna Grace and 25 others were killed in the Sandy Hook Newtown shooting about 8 years ago. Rob also shared a sweet article about Jimmy and his spouse Nelva's response to the shooting after 1 year. And Nelva was a therapist who would spend a career counseling mentally ill and troubled young people. And she said, "At the end of the day, I don't know why this happened. I didn't get to choose it, but I get to choose my response now. I do get to choose now." And then she said, "People say to me, I can't believe what that monster did to your baby. Well, you know, it's true. Something terrible happened to Anna, and that was a terrible day." And Nelva says, "But if we even use that language, monster, if we talk like that, we already make a separation between us and them. And it doesn't work that way. Nelva refused to hate." And she continued saying, "I don't even remember how it all got started. I just remember it just became a chant in our house shortly after the shooting. We just needed to keep Anna alive. We needed to keep her spirit with us." So she says, "Love wins. This is what we taught Anna, to honor, to praise, and to be loving. The religion of Jesus makes the love ethic central. Owe no one anything except to love one another. Why should we love not only our one another, but also love our neighbors of any race, gender, political affiliations, or country of origin? The Bible reminds us we are commanded to love others, not because we are good or holy, not because our faith is strong, and not because we are so moral. In Ephesians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul says, walk in love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant sacrificial offering to God. We are commanded to love others because God is merciful. God is forgiving and loving. In spite of our doubts, skepticism, uncertainty and ambiguity and confusion, God would be patient with us. And God shows his mercies. His mercies are new every morning. And God is abounding in steadfast love. Professor Richard Boyce recently wrote that Jesus' command to love must be translated into action. He says, with regard to power and prosperity, our property and position, And Professor Richard reminds me of one of the discussions we had during our virtual coffee hour this past week. And our topic was food and faith. And a church member, Beverly Howard, said something like, "When we share food with others, we share Jesus with others." And just this week, it was reported that 1 in 8 American households doesn't have enough to eat every day. We can show love with words and actions. Friends, this is a difficult season that we all go through. We go through changes at work, changes at school, changes even at home and here at church. Our love is being tested. Our patience is being tested daily. And this is also a season in which we have an opportunity to love others every day. May we choose love. When Rob sent his email to Walt and me, in the last line of his message, he wrote, "May we all have the compassion to look forward with love. To God be the glory. Amen."
Where true love and charity are found, God is always there. Since the love of Christ has brought us all together, let us all rejoice and be glad now. Let everyone love the Lord God, the living God, and with sincere hearts let us love each other now. Where true love and charity are found, God is always there. Therefore, when we gather as one in Christ Jesus, let our love enfold each race, creed, every person. Let envy, division, and strife cease among us. May Christ our Lord dwell among us in every heart.
Let us join together for prayer and the Lord's Prayer. This prayer is written by Jill Duffield and appeared in the Presbyterian Outlook. Let us pray. Almighty God, we approach you with reverence and with hope, aware that we often lack the words to express our deepest fears and our most heartfelt needs. We are confident that because before a word is on our lips, you know it completely. We believe your promise of presence, the certainty of your providence, and we believe your power to work for good in ways that we may not see, but surely can trust. Relying on your grace, we bring to you the cares of the world and the concerns of our community, the worries that keep us up at night. Lord, as we see images of destruction, of communities in flames and entire towns destroyed by winds and water, we pray for those impacted by natural disasters. Sustain the weary, strengthen the weak, empower your people to be helpers to those desperate for relief. Do not let us shrink from loving our neighbors now and through the long months of recovery that are yet to come. We remember, too, the many among us feeling crushed under the weight of this persistent pandemic. Comfort those who grieve. Heal the sick. Encourage the caregivers. Provide for your people unable to make ends meet. Make of your followers those who fish for people and mend the communal safety nets that keep your children from drowning when the storms of life churn. Knowing that we are put in community to care for each other, that our fate is inextricably tied to that of others, we pray to be peacemakers and ambassadors of reconciliation, to work for ways of life together that bind us up rather than tear us down. We pray that we might let loose mercy, that we might ever pursue justice. Gracious God, you hear the cries of your people and you find a way to set them free, free from oppression, free from exploitation, free from anything that prevents the abundant life Christ came to give. As partakers of your grace, we boldly ask to be participants in your kingdom's coming until that time when every tribe and every nation is healed and whole, gathered together in praising our Savior and Lord, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us be glad in our Maker. Let us rejoice in our King. Let us praise God's name with dancing and with music, and let us bring to God our tithes in our offerings. comes from the Heidelberg Catechism, chapter 4. Our only comfort in life and in death is that we belong, body and soul, in life and in death, not to ourselves, but to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who at the cost of his own blood has fully paid for all our sins and has completely freed us from the dominion of the devil. That he protects us so well that without the will of our Father in heaven, not a hair can fall from our heads. Indeed, that everything must fit his purpose for our salvation. Therefore, by his Holy Spirit, he also assures us of eternal life and makes us wholeheartedly willing and ready from now on to live for him. Amen.
Dear friends, go out into the world in peace. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.